On today's show, actress and comedy writer Colleen Werthmann stops by. We talk about what to expect in 2017, and I try to prove to her that I'm really intelligent. Also, film critic Michael Snyder tells us which movies we should be seeing before the Oscars. Stay with us. We have a great show.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please, friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. There is a treasure trove of episodes, back episodes, just great stuff. Just you can spend hours exploring the website, davidfeldmanshow.com. And while you're there, become a premium subscriber. For only $5 a month, you can gain access to all our premium content. Also, you'll see Amazon banners. The site is lousy with Amazon banners. Click on it, then do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, and we get a small percentage of it. Hey, you know, 2017 is turning out to be an interesting year. We did an episode on Israel where we kind of explained what's going on in Gaza, the West Bank, Palestine, Israel. And I cannot believe the response it's getting. Check it out. Go to the David Feldman Show website. It's up there. Or subscribe to the show on iTunes. We have a YouTube channel. We have a YouTube channel. You can listen to this show on YouTube now. Check it out. We have a really informative, interesting episode about Israel. And I am, thank you. I cannot thank my listeners enough. I am absolutely shocked by how many downloads that episode got. So thank you. We're going to do more informative shows without opinion. We're going to teach and educate and learn. Stay with us. This, my New Year's resolution is to say hot mess as much as possible.
You are at the cutting edge of 2013, David. Just the cutting edge. God help us. Soon you'll be hashtagging.
Mm-hmm.
Ugh.
Colleen Werthmann joins us.
Hi.
I'm back. You're back with your tail.
What?
Between your legs. You came back from L.A. It proved too much for the girl.
I told you about my tail in private. That was supposed to be a secret between you and me. Ugh.
Colleen Werthmann, I walked into the studio, I saw you, and I literally got a lump in my throat. I almost started to cry. I was so happy to see you. It was like a gift.
I did not feel the same way.
I know, and I didn't want to talk to you. I said, I'm just going to save it for my listeners. Colleen Werthmann, you've seen her.
He literally gave me the silent treatment, like a weird diva clutching his legal pad.
Colleen Werthmann,
saving it for the show. Give me a fucking break.
Has written for The Nightly Show. She has been an actress. You've seen her in The Sopranos.
Actor.
So it wasn't a tail between your legs.
And whether you have a tail has nothing to do with your gender.
Well, I said it wasn't a tail. It was something else.
This is going pear-shaped real fast. Let's just plow forward with this awful autobiography.
Okay. You've been in the movie Sisters.
Yeah.
You've been in The Sopranos.
Yeah.
And you're currently running a show out in Hollywood.
I'm not the show runner. I am the head writer.
You're the head writer.
Yeah.
And what is the name of that show?
It's called Throwing Shade. It's going to be on TV Land starting January 17th. It's once a week on Tuesday nights.
And my listeners would find this interesting because this show is a podcast.
It has been a podcast. Now it's going to be
a TV show.
I'm
talking about my show is a podcast.
Oh, yes.
And there's a very popular podcast out there called Throwing Shade.
Yes.
That is being turned into a television show.
Correct.
And I have an announcement to make.
Ooh. And what's that?
This podcast.
Yes.
In February.
Uh-huh.
Is going to be an email. So watch out for that.
Okay.
Because Alex Brazell, my producer,
uh-huh,
he's really taking care of me in 2017.
Oh.
Boy, did he give me a look.
He gave me...
That's because you're throwing him under the bus during your friggin' podcast. What do you expect?
That was a sign of love. Well, okay. Maybe not. How is Los Angeles?
You know, it's fine. It's perfectly pleasant. It's spacious as hell. Like, one time in the first few weeks that I was there, I went to a Trader Joe's at like 8 o'clock at night because I needed to get some groceries or whatever. And I was like, oh, Lord, give me strength. Just girding my loins, right? Because if you know what a shit show it is in New York, if you go to the Trader Joe's, there's a line all the way around the perimeter of the store, like out the door. Like one block
right.
Just to get to the checkout.
Yeah.
So I was like, fuck my life. Like, why did I put this off? I got in there. David, there were six customers in the entire fucking store. Like, my head cracked open. Like, rainbows were pouring out. I was like, la! I was like, what the fuck is going on here? There's enough grocery stores for everyone. It was spacious as hell. It's just, you know, it's an easy, if... You know, less gravitas-y lifestyle. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and I think the people...
Not that there isn't gravitas out there, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I love L.A. I do. I left just because there are laws and...
You violated them and you were kicked out of the state. Right. I mean, that happens.
You can be happy in Los Angeles.
Sure.
You really can.
Yeah, and, theoretically, and I, indeed.
And the
just like here.
And there's culture there. There really
yeah,
is.
No, there is.
There was a time when people moved to L.A. for the sole purpose of making money.
Right.
And everybody went to L.A. to make money.
Mm-hmm.
And then nobody made money. And they were stuck there. And this happened in
nobody like, made – because there's a lot of rich people in
there are
LA.
A lot of rich people. But most people aren't making money. And most people aren't working. So what happened was there was a time when you left.
Mm-hmm.
People were on like a 5-year plan.
Mm-hmm.
But people stayed in Los Angeles. And these cultures of you know, these little pockets of artisanal people
sure.
sprung up. And you can – it's a vital
A very
culture.
Exciting art cult, visual art culture, very yeah. exciting comedy culture.
Yes. And this is recent. Even
yeah.
like the Comedy Store now mm-hmm. is phenomenal. Like the comedy
yeah,
store.
Yeah, I live actually, well, I'm staying out there just a couple blocks away from
yeah.
the, oh, no, no, the Laugh Factory is where it's close to me.
The Laugh Factory. Yeah. Alex and I were out there for my divorce. Alex came with me. He did.
Wow.
Yes, he did my divorce. He was Exhibit A. and we played the Comedy Store and it was so much fun and vital, and there was like an energy in the room that was,
mm-hmm.
felt like very much like New York. Yeah, you can move to Los Angeles, but there's drift. I was talking to somebody about this.
What do you mean drift?
In New York, and New York to me is new.
Mm-hmm.
My listeners know that I lived in L.A. for 20-some
right.
odd years.
All of the eight... basement masturbators.
We are actually, well, they are basement masturbators. That's true. That is absolutely true about my
yeah.
listeners, and proudly so.
Oh, well, just owning it, I suppose, is the move.
Basement masturbators. I think that that's brilliant. Also, shit show made me laugh. I've heard that expression.
You are just hearing shit show?
No, no, no. I just
God
said,
help
I've,
you, David.
No, no. I've heard the expression shit show. But for some reason, coming out of your mouth, I actually pictured it. Not because of your mouth.
I always imagine like a musical theater sort of chorus, like doing a dance together in unison, and they're like all covered in poo-poo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's anyway, there's drift in Los Angeles. I talked about these pockets of artisanal creative types.
Mm-hmm.
That's a new phenomenon in
sure.
L.A. I'd say that started in the aughts, maybe the 90s, where people stayed and committed to the community.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with that in L.A. is you can drift. You can wake up one day and be 5 years older and not be working and not know that you're not working.
You feel like New York is like that, too?
I don't know. I think it's this grid where you're constantly checking the bottom line.
Mm.
I think if you are in New York and you're not – and you're getting out of bed because that's the toughest thing to do in New York City is to get out of bed and meet the day. But if you're doing that, I don't see how you can survive in New York City without confronting the truth.
Well, I mean, it's certainly a more compressed life here in that people are packed closer together and it's more expensive in terms of like real estate. I mean, you certainly get more for your money out there, even though I would say that, you know,
I'm talking about how you view your life.
Is this interesting at all, this New York versus L.A. nonsense that we're talking about?
Well, you're back. It's the truth. You're back from L.A.
Yeah.
And they're busy in the basement masturbating right now. They're just blasting this so the wife can't hear them crying.
Like that movie Together? Did you ever see that movie?
No.
Oh, it's like some like Swedish or Norwegian. Like, well, it was released here as an independent film, but... There's this, it's about the 70s, like this sort of tumultuous time in this family. And the husband, like, has this quote unquote wood workshop in the basement. And he looks at, like, you know, cheesecake porn, like a Playboy type of thing.
Right.
And he pretends to be, like, he's hammering with one hand.
And he's
like,
hammering
while he's
with
like,
it.
Look, yeah.
He's hammering.
Funny.
Let me do my joke.
Yeah. What? Let you do your joke? Fuck you. You're not interrupting me with nonsensical jokes today, by the way.
That's all I do.
Well, you do it to me, but you don't do it to Gary Shandling. You don't do it to Alan's wife, Belle, when he comes on your show.
Yes, I do.
No, you absolutely do not.
I do it.
I've listened, and I'm telling you,
you
not
listen
true.
To this?
Yes, I have listened to it. Not every single one, because I'm not a masochist. I listen when you have people on who are interesting to me.
All right. So you'll listen to this show.
Sometimes.
This specific episode. Will you listen to an episode you did with me?
Yes.
And
make sure I'm not going insane.
Right. And you sometimes have been a little concerned.
Yes.
About how I treated you.
Yes.
Or what I provoked.
Yes. Yes. In that I think that many times you engage with me in a manipulative, non-sincere way.
Playing devil's advocate, perhaps.
Or any number of rhetorical Rube Goldberg machines. Yeah.
But that's who I am.
Are you, though?
Yeah, I am. I am.
I don't know.
We've
also had many sincere on-the-level conversations.
Right, but I think there's a dishonesty to me on the show. I'm serious.
Okay.
I think I'm honest, but... I'm also very dishonest in order to provoke conversation. And I think most people, except for you, understand what I'm doing.
Oh, so it's my density.
I'm saying that sometimes
your manipulative tactics.
If this were just a show where I agreed with everything you said, it would be boring. There has to be conflict. There has to be opposing views. Otherwise, it's a snore fest.
This isn't a play. This is a conversation.
But a conversation is generally interesting.
Nice R's and L's, by the way.
Thank you. I was imitating Tom Brokaw having a stroke. But that I sometimes ask you questions to poke at you.
Yeah, and my response to that is that's completely unnecessary.
But
this is already getting boring and annoying.
Well, but if we agreed, it would be a conversation that my listeners would be overhearing at Starbucks, assuming that Starbucks had a basement.
Hang on, we're assuming in a basement where you can masturbate. All right,
okay.
You've already hit that too hard. Now it's lost its sheen. But you don't engage in the same manipulative tactics with Frank Conniff.
Yes, I do.
And you guys you agree on a lot of things.
Oh,
with
no,
him.
You didn't hear the last show. We were fighting on the last show.
Really?
Yes.
Because you were trying to manipulate him?
And I actually said it on the show.
Okay, well, at least you're being more honest about your...
But how is it being manipulative?
Because you have your little legal pad with all your little questions.
Yeah.
And you don't let anybody know ahead of time what we're going to be talking about.
What are you, Donna Brazile? You have to give the questions to Hillary before the debate starts?
Well, maybe if I had, we wouldn't be where we are now. Fuck our lives. Come on, let's talk about something more interesting.
This
is not interesting.
Well, it is interesting.
To whom?
Because I've been doing stand-up, and I manipulate the audience. I say...
Well, yeah, but that's a unidirectional output.
Yeah.
A conversation is bidirectional.
What does that mean?
It means it goes both ways.
Okay.
When you're doing jokes and the audience reacts, that's stand-up. You're not having a conversation with the audience.
Well, it's the only human interaction I have.
Clearly.
Seriously, I'm in a vacuum lately. I haven't been in a vacuum this tight since my mother tried to abort me.
I like that joke.
I just made it up.
It was nice.
Thank
it
you.
Was good.
It's just cannot be used anywhere.
Well, that's a back pocketer for sure.
Can you joke about abortion on stage? There's a couple of rules to comedy that I have written down. One is you can't get a laugh with the phrase snuff video. And it used to be, well, they're not laughing because they don't know what a snuff video is.
Everyone and then, knows what that is.
You know what a snuff video
sure.
is. I found out no matter what, even if the audience knows what a snuff video is, they're not going to laugh at it.
Well, but do you feel
cancer,
also like...
Cancer used to be you couldn't get a laugh with the word cancer. Because of the advances in medicine, people laugh at the word cancer.
Well, like, have you seen Lori Kilmartin's 45 jokes about my dead dad? It's fucking awesome. It's so funny, so smart, and so good. I mean,
do you know Felicia Michaels?
Yeah, we were on this podcast together one time.
Do you friend her on Facebook? Do you read what she writes?
I don't know if I'm Facebook friends with her. I follow her on Twitter.
You should friend her on Facebook.
Okay,
everybody should friend Felicia on Facebook. She's probably at her maximum. So just follow her on Facebook. She writes these.
Oh, is that what you can do if somebody is at their max?
Yeah.
You follow them.
You follow them.
Oh, that's good to know. Okay.
She writes these essays.
Uh-huh.
And this morning I woke up and she wrote an essay about Lori Kilmartin's new special.
Yeah, it's on CISO.
About her dad dying, which I'm going to go see. But Felicia is an amazing writer. And, you know, she plays this ditzy blonde.
Right. Her character is deceptive.
You're right. And I'm going to be honest with you. She's been writing some stuff lately, and I read it. I could never write as well as she does. Just it's so pointed and poignant and spot on. And
is she writing about cancer? Is that why you brought this up?
Because this morning I got up and Felicia had written about Lori's special.
Mm-hmm.
And Felicia should write a book. You know, she's just a great writer.
She's such an interesting person,
but
too.
But back to my question about abortion.
I'll answer it.
You
don't need to restate it. Jenna Friedman, have you seen her show?
No.
American Cunt? Very funny. I think it's also on, it's either on CISO. No, you watch your mouth. Yes.
American. Very.
American Cunt.
That I'm fine with.
She talks a lot about abortion in that set. And she calls abortions a bobos, which really makes me laugh. She's another person to follow on Twitter, not because she's joke heavy, but because of the intensity with which she engages in politics. Wow.
I mean, what is her name again?
Jenna Friedman, J-E-N-A Friedman.
I probably follow her.
Yeah, I feel like you would remember if you did.
There are a lot of Friedmans in my life.
Indeed. I mean, in everyone's lives.
And is she a comedian?
She's a comedian, a comic.
So is
What is with you in like feminine suffixes? Suffices?
I don't know.
It's so old school.
I know.
Like really stale. You got to switch that up. Now that you're getting into cool words like shit show, you should update your suffixes to just like the gender neutral version.
So you don't you don't like being called a white
white bitch?
A writress.
No.
You're not a writress.
No.
You're just a writer.
Yeah, and I'm also just an actor.
When did that change on us, though?
I mean, so many years ago, David.
Like when?
Like the fucking 80s, dude. So long ago.
Then why do we have...
Because you're hopelessly out of touch.
Okay, then for the Oscars, there's going to be the category of Best Actor and Best Actor. They're going to be two...
Well, soon, once the Academy realizes that gender is a continuum, hashtag fluidity... There will just be, like, best performers. best actors. I think so.
Do you think
the idea of gendered performance is like very real, obviously, because our gender roles in movies are so kind of stuck.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think in the future it will be more ambiguous. It'll be like best human portraying
of
us something.
The 0.00001% of the population that is fluid?
Yes.
Is it that low? I mean, I would
assume. No, it's not that low.
But, well, so you would prefer.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying I think that will happen.
That's happening.
It will happen.
Because people don't identify as male or female.
Yeah, and the idea of like a gendered performance is preposterous when you think about it.
Why?
Because we're all human beings and craft is not a gendered thing.
Judy Dench playing Hamlet notwithstanding.
I'm not talking about playing a male role. I'm just saying that the actual art of acting requires zero, like, gender-specific skills.
I get that with race. I've always been amazed.
It's the same thing. I'm telling you, it's the same thing.
So
you've just not thought about it this way.
And
that's why you're having a hard time with it.
So I could go see The Odd Couple.
Mm-hmm.
And
no, but this, again, that's like, you're using the wrong example.
Well, hang on. I'm just... Help me out here, because this is all new to me.
Yeah, but you're already using the wrong example. You're saying, oh, like a woman's role, or like a male role that's adapted to a female role.
No, a female playing a traditionally male role.
I wasn't going to say that.
What are you saying, man?
God, let's pick it up.
God, I wish I was. If I had like half your brain, I'd be so happy. Plus, mine, I'd like to just take your brain and keep it in a jar and.
Then I'll just be a vegetable over here? No thanks.
What I'm saying is The Odd Couple could be Jack Klugman, and instead of Tony Randall, it could be Sally Struthers who did play, or Meryl Streep playing Felix. That's what you're saying.
I'm saying any actor can play any role.
So, right. So Meryl Streep could play a man.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. I agree with you on that.
But also, like, whether you're, if you're a woman playing a female role or a man playing a male role, like, the craft of acting, analyzing text, understanding beats, investing it with your own personal experiences, like, are those gendered if you are a particular gender? Sure. But, like, the actual technical aspect of acting, which are like dynamics and vulnerability and things like that. Those are just human things.
Shakespeare understood the fluidity of gender.
Absolutely. He was actually quite rad in his way.
How so?
Well, like, he has one of the only cold female characters, which is Cordelia. Like, Cordelia is like, yeah, you're my dad. I like you.
Is this King Lear?
Yeah. She's like, yeah, you're my dad. I love you. But it's not like I'm going to kiss your ass in order to get what I want from you. Like, she's just very frank.
Mm-hmm.
And
he had that. He had the first African-American name in a Elizabethan.
Well, it would be African-British, no?
No.
Or just African.
That would be correct. But Cordelia is an African-American name. And I was always...
Now?
Well, yeah.
This is a bad path to go down.
Let's not go
get
down.
Get back
there.
On the path.
Well, what about identity politics in Hollywood?
Oh.
You say one day we're going to have just best actor instead of best actor and best actress. And you think that's a good thing.
Well, I have a suspicion that as we go along, people will be like, why are men grouped in one area and women grouped in another when acting is like, it's not like sports where you can do a better job if you're like taller or stronger. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, there are certain reasons why, like, there's men's basketball and women's basketball. Like, that, I'm like, okay, fair enough.
Right.
But, like, in acting, it doesn't matter if you're 4.5 feet tall or 7 feet tall. Like, it's not about physical feats, quote unquote. Like, maybe if you're a stunt person, that those things come into play. But I do think, I do wonder if, like, 50 years from now, there will just be, like, awards.
I question...
For genres.
I question who wants that. I notice with performers, especially with comedy, they embrace their separateness. People embrace the fact that they're Asian, gay, Jewish, Chinese.
Yeah, well, it's like your hook, your identity thing.
Right. And I've come around to it. I used to say I had the French worldview, you know, melt. Just talk about the human experience. Don't start off by talking about that you're a fat person.
You know, and you mean the French sort of idea that you
get rid of
you
your
lose
burka.
Your identity thing and then we're all this in
we're
this
all French.
Thing together.
Take off your burkini.
Right.
In America, everybody, at least in stand-up, says, hey, I'm black. I'm Jewish. This is who I am.
Right.
In the past, have found it to be one-dimensional.
Well, it certainly can be.
It can be.
And there's theater like that also. Awful shows like, my father's Italian, my mother's Jewish, and I'm in therapy. Like those just deadly off-Broadway shows that attract busloads of, like, commuters.
Well, both sides of the political spectrum want that. There's a, there, on both sides.
Wait, want what?
That with liberals and progressives who identify their struggle, who live through their struggle. If you're a liberal, you see a woman on stage. You see a woman performing, and she has that struggle, and it's sacred. And if you're a conservative, you see a woman, or you see a gay person, or you see a black person. You can't get past that.
What is there to get past?
Well, a racist Republican. We always accuse the Republicans of being racist.
Right.
Inherently racist.
Right.
And we say they cannot get past the fact that you're black. When you talk to liberals, they can't get past the fact that somebody's black.
Okay, so where are you going with this?
Well, I'm saying that the separateness, when you say it's all going to blend into best actor instead of actor and actress, I'm saying I'm not so sure here in America we want that. I think both sides are kind of in favor of dividing.
Well, here's the thing. Maybe...
Respond to that. Don't try to be you always accuse me of being manipulative. Live and breathe in that moment.
Well, I don't know what is there to respond to. Is there a question there?
It's a profound observation that I just made.
What am I supposed to say? It's profound? I mean,
no, I'll say it for you.
Well, good, because I'm not gonna.
Did they talk about this on the nightly show?
Talk about what?
What I just said. No.
No, because I think everything was either like, this is racist, like,
so I just
everyone would agree with.
In all honesty, I just threw you, this is a podcast.
Right.
We can let things breathe. I just said something really important.
Which is that Republicans can't get past identity politics and neither can liberals?
They can't get past people's exterior. Both sides can't do it.
Well, so and what, though?
And what is... Well, we have more in common than we claim. And this...
When you say we, though, who do you mean?
I think both sides of the aisle have more in common when it comes to race and gender and religion than we're manipulated into believing. And so the question is, and I'm not... drinking the Trump water, and maybe I am being a bit of a provocateur by asking you this question. Is there racism and sexism on the left? And the answer is yes.
Oh, of course.
And the answer
is
yes.
I mean, that's a different, that's a totally different thing than you were just talking about, but sure.
No, it isn't.
How's it different? I mean, it's rhetorically quite different.
No, it isn't. I was saying that the Republicans are always accused of being racist and wanting to, you know, divide, and they cannot get past people.
Well, like, you know about the shit show going on at Pantsuit Nation right now, right?
Let me finish my, you just made an accusation. This is good, by the way.
No, it's not. It's annoying.
No, it isn't.
You're acting all like umbragy today.
No, I'm not.
Look at you. Yes, you are. Putting on this hat of like, oh, now today I'll act like Colleen. I'll be the offended one.
No, I'm just saying that there's racism on the left and there's sexism on the left.
Are you trying to teach me this? Like, I've never thought of it before. It's preposterous, dude. You've got to be fucking kidding me.
Why?
Because obviously I know that. Well, I'm not a fucking idiot.
But what kind, how is it similar and how is it different?
Then what? To what? Then what?
What is the difference between the left's racism and sexism?
The left pretends it's not racist and is offended if it's accused of being racist. Republicans are like, yeah, you know what? Because blacks are fucking lazy.
Okay. Statistically, that does. Republicans will go on. Statistically, when they poll Republicans, they do say that black people are lazy.
Yeah. And that all they want is handouts and blah, 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 blah. And not just blacks, Mexicans, everybody.
Right.
Who's not white.
And tell me.
Except Asians.
And tell me about the racism on the left.
I just did.
What would they say about black people?
That black people are systematically, disempowered by poverty and the legacy of slavery and da 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 da.
Right. And there is a what.
But like, are you following what's going on with Pantsuit Nation right now? Let me fucking make a point, please.
Go ahead.
Are you following what's going on in Pantsuit Nation right now? Do you know about this?
Is this about Hillary? Is this?
Well, it was initially started as like a Hillary fan group on Facebook or whatever. And it's basically in the last like 2-3 weeks has completely imploded because of all these white people like attacking people of color for wanting to talk about women of color, feminist issues or women's issues. It's like a very, very unsuccessful. I mean, even as the Pantsuit Nation is getting a book deal, which allegedly is, you know, donating proceeds to all these lefty groups and da 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 da. It's increasingly become a place where women of color and feminists of color feel totally marginalized, left out, criticized for wanting to actually speak from their own experiences in, like, say, their own thread, which is ridiculous.
I'm not following what this is.
Well, I mean, maybe you just got to look at it to see what it is.
It's called Pantsuit Nation.
Yeah, everyone knows what this is. There's like millions and millions of people on it.
Right, and it's women identifying as...
Initially, it was just Hillary supporters. I mean, it's generally lefties. It's not like middle-of-the-road, you know, indie voters who were really into Hillary. It tends to be like lefties.
How did the lefties end up turning on each other?
Well, the same way that all lefties turn on each other, and basically the same way that all righties turn on each other, because they feel one group feels that they're right about one thing, and passionate.
And where are the lefties on what, on racial lines that where are they turning on each other?
Yeah, well, there are like white feminists who are extremely offended that that women of color think that they're racist for not wanting to have a women of color only thread. Well, why can't I participate in it? Say the white feminists. And the feminists of color are like, well, because we want to have our own thing over here. And they're mm-hmm. like, well, why can't I learn from you? You know, it's that kind of shit.
Yeah. And?
And that's...
So, well, that's interesting to me because that is...
That's why I fucking told you about it.
Yeah.
So don't cut me off next time.
All right. Whew. I did a show. I did a benefit for the ACLU. Alex, you want to come in here for a second?
No.
Should I talk about it? We've been doing benefits for the ACLU.
Right.
And thank you all for coming out and supporting free speech. And we raised a lot of money.
Nice. How much?
It was like
Nice. It was a Union Hall, right? That little space in the downstairs where there's the bar in the back?
I think like close to $800. Nice. It was Fugel, Sang, and me, and Conniff, and a couple of other people. And it made me feel good because of the divorce, I haven't been able to afford my charitable giving. Charitable?
Are you Tom Brokaw having a stroke again?
And I do these, we do these benefits.
Mm-hmm.
Really, you know, Alex says, let's do it for the ACLU. I don't give a shit. I just want the stage time. I just want
to. You're just an attention whore.
Yeah. I don't care what it's for.
You'll ally yourself with some cause.
I would do it for the alt-right if it had stage time behind it.
I would love to see you performing at an alt-right benefit.
I would kill. I would kill.
Actually, I think you would do very well.
Oh, my God. The best audience.
Because you're a white-looking Jew.
The Jew part, maybe not so. But
But you look like a regular white person.
Thank
you
very
much.
If I change my name, could I pass?
Yes. I do think you could pass.
Thank you. Anyway. It made me feel good that I was able to raise money for the ACLU without having to go out of pocket. but you do go out of pocket.
Here, I've got a new name for you once you get an alt-right identity. Steve Kritzenheimer.
Well,
it's very Wisconsin.
Kritzenheimer could
But it's more German than Jewish. It's not German-Jewish. It's just straight-up German.
Wiesenheimer.
Yeah, it's like a Wisconsin German.
How about Wiesenheimer?
So that's too cutesy.
But so people would mispronounce
too on the nose,
it. Mr. Weisenheimer? No, yeah, it's Wiesenheimer.
But it's very Jewish to correct the pronunciation, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pronunciation. Not pronunciation, pronunciation.
Okay. Enjoy that stroke.
Yeah.
It smells like almonds in here.
Are you having a stroke?
No, you are. It's just the waft of almonds coming from your brain is so strong that I can smell it over here across the table.
Wow. That was like three levels of comedy right there.
You know, that's how I do. Yeah. That's why they pay me the
big bucks.
So
basically what you were saying is that I'm smelling almonds because I'm about to have a stroke.
Yeah.
And the stroke is so massive that you're getting secondhand stroke.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Instead of secondhand smoke.
Indeed.
Secondhand stroke. Yes. So we do the benefit for the ACLU and we're going to be doing more of these.
Yay.
And thank you for coming out and watching great comedy. So after the show, there were three British women.
Uh-oh. I don't know why that's dangerous.
Who complained about the old white guy.
Okay. And what was their complaint?
She complained.
I'm assuming these were elderly white women also.
No, these were young.
Okay.
Leftists who came out to support the ACLU.
Why the fuck do they care about the ACLU?
I don't know. And they complained about Frank and me. Conniff and me. Frank had a joke about Donald Trump wanting to bang Ivanka, which is a trope now.
Well, it's, yeah.
And so Frank is the funniest man in the world.
So funny.
But a joke about Donald and Ivanka having sex is played out. So if you're going to criticize Frank for doing...
It's not because it's sexist, it's because it's hacky.
Right.
Right.
And these British women complained.
But what was the actual complaint?
That they were sexualizing Ivanka.
All right.
And that it's an attack on her as a woman.
Where have they been this whole time?
They said it was kind of violent towards her. And I was kind of listening. Alex got into it with them. Alex got deeply offended.
I have to say, I really don't care if people are offended by jokes. I just am not interested in that as a topic. I know that there's more like censoriousness. Is that the word? Yeah.
Yeah.
In like comedy going public now. And there's certainly more people, as I understand it, groaning. I mean, I have to say also, just like as a sidebar, like I don't really care about stand-up related issues because I'm not a stand-up, although I certainly sympathize with like an artist putting their work out there and getting ragged on for like programmatic belief-based reasons.
Mm-hmm. But this isn't about stand-up. This is about freedom of speech. And the ACLU and these three women.
It's ironic, to try to censor someone's speech or criticize someone's speech in support of an organization that vehemently protects it.
So I perform without my Warby Parkers on,
mm-hmm.
or a baseball cap. Mm-hmm. I go out on stage without my glasses and without a hat, and I'm now wearing my Warby Parkers
mm-hmm.
and a baseball cap. And I look different. I'm wearing an overcoat.
So they didn't recognize
They me. Didn't know who they were
and
talking to.
And you're sitting right next to them.
No, I'm standing after the show.
Right.
And Alex and I are talking to these three, the three witches from Macbeth. And they...
Were they that powerful, though?
Yeah. They really got under my skin. They really did. I've been... This conversation... So she says, and then the other old white guy... And I go, yeah... Like, now she's talking about me
mm-hmm.
without her even knowing that she's talking to me. So that other old white guy called Lena Dunham grotesque, and he was fat-shaming her. So I do this joke. And this isn't about stand-up comedy, by the way. This is just about freedom of speech. And I agree with the politically correct, by the way. I agree with them for monitoring speech, unless I'm on the receiving end of it.
Clearly.
I have a joke. You know, there was a shooting today, mass shooting. It's horrible, but it is nice to see something disgusting and repulsive on television without everybody telling me what a genius Lena Dunham is.
Well, I mean, one could also argue that jumping to the conclusion that that is appearance-based shaming
Thank you.
Is Alex sexist just, and reductive. Is that Al- was that your hot take? Alex and I have the same hot That's, take.
So I was kind
because
of...
Because I wish I had an abortion. Like, that is fucking preposterous.
It was like I don't mean to be pretentious, but it is Shakespearean as, like, the king dressing up as a pauper to talk to his people. Is that measure to measure? Anyway,
I don't really know measure for measure very well. That's one of my lessons.
In that case,
lesser...
it is from measure to measure.
Oh.
Okay. So,
are you sure it's not all's well that ends well?
Okay. So I was the king now in disguise.
Yeah, I bet you were the fucking king.
Dressed up talking to the peasants, the people mm-hmm. who come see me. And she didn't know.
Wait, you just said they were the witches.
I don't
know. So doesn't that, in fact, make you the ghost of Banquo?
Okay.
In the, you're already dead.
All right. So,
piping hot Shakespeare refs.
this is my one Macbeth joke, and then okay, you're insane.
But I want to. Too bad that's a title, not a place.
Okay, so you're insane.
Hashtag who knows what Thane means.
The Thane of Cotter.
Yeah, but that's a title. It's like the Earl or like the Viscount.
I know. It was a pun.
I know.
I want to talk to.
I know what a pun is.
I'm going to get to why they hate us and these jokes.
Why they hate us? Who do you mean by they? And
people
who, do you mean
who
by
go
us?
Make jokes like you're insane. I'm going to get to that in a second because it's really an offensive joke, and it's why people voted for Trump. Just how elitist it is, and
making fun of people with lisps.
No,
I got yelled at my show the other day
for
making I did a run of. Jokes about how much I hate Emma Stone's lisp in a headline pass.
So the king.
And it was not received well.
Okay. King liberal. Me. I mean, if they could form alternative energy out of my boiling blood from Donald Trump, we could fuel.
Untold turbines.
I mean, my mother, you bring up. I mean, she says things about Trump that I say to my mother, you know, if the secret, you can't talk this way.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot talk about him. I hate him. You know, I would like to have a prayer circle in Central Park where we pray we bring all the liberals out in Central Park, and
so
we
they can get nuked.
Well, we pray for Donald Trump and Mike Pence's arterial sclerosis, shall we say?
Okay.
I don't think the Secret Service can arrest us for praying for. Is that wrong to pray for?
Well, I feel like religion is more protected than ever now.
Right. So
with the incipient passage of FATA and other things like that.
FATA?
Yeah, the First Amendment Defense Act.
Oh, for religion.
Yeah.
Oh.
The congressional bill that would allow basically permit religious-based bigotry, i.e., like, I refuse to make your gay wedding cake because you're an abomination.
That's called FATA.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was first proposed in Congress in 2015 and reproposed.
No, Alan Sherman came up with that. Hello, mother, hello, FATA.
Ugh. You should truly be ashamed of yourself.
I should
just retire now.
I'm ashamed.
There's no jersey going up to the rafters after that.
As a self-hating Jew, I'm ashamed that I knew.
You should hate yourself a lot more now.
The best joke I wrote 2016. Mm. Best joke, hands down. I submitted it to Triumph on that show. I try to get Marty Short to do. Best joke I've written that nobody
What
used.
Is it? Stop hyping it.
Bernie Sanders is running for president. This is the best joke I wrote all year.
Stop hyping it. Just fucking say
it. It's a great joke.
Well, can I hear it, please?
Do you worry that Bernie Sanders, as president, being Jewish, would have a dual loyalty if America ever went to war with Alan Sherman records?
Very good.
It's the best joke I wrote all year.
I thought the punchline was going to be Krepla. Okay.
And both.
I should have seen it coming.
I submitted them to that joke to two separate television shows.
Well, you know what? It would have killed in 1955.
No, it wouldn't have been funny in 1950. First of all, Alan Sherman, by the way, was producing I've Got a Secret in 1955.
What is that? A game show?
It was a television show. Okay. He was not performing it. He didn't begin.
I completely don't care about anything you're telling me.
Well, do you know how brilliant Alan Sherman is?
No.
Well, there you go. Go look up Alan Sherman.
Fair enough. Maybe I shall.
The king of song parodies, to the point where the man
better
was
than Tom Lehrer?
I would say funnier than Tom Lehrer. You know, Alan Sherman didn't make you feel smart. You just wet your pants laughing at him. Excuse me. People should look up Alan Sherman.
All right.
And learn who he is. Because he, as funny as Mel Brooks, if not funnier, in terms of being more prolific and just being a great comedy mind. So underrated and so big. Alan Sherman's so big and popular for about 4 years.
Hmm. Then why did he fall off? Because he moved into game shows?
No. He went from game shows.
Oh, okay.
To performing.
Okay.
So big. He produced Bill Cosby's albums. I think he had personal demons.
Oh, okay.
So I have not lost the train of this conversation.
I have.
ACLU benefit.
Oh, yes.
So I'm the king now is dressed as a civilian talking to his people.
Right.
In his Warby Parker and his.
So then what happened?
So she's going to. And that other old white guy. That joke about Lena Dunham body shaming Lena Dunham, calling her repulsive. And I said, well, I don't think I changed my voice. I don't think he was body shaming.
That sounds like your real voice.
Okay. I said, I don't think he's body shaming. I think he's just calling her a repulsive human being. How dare he call her a repulsive human being? He's objectifying. Then finally I said, I wasn't objectifying her.
And were they like, what?
And then they really got angry when they realized they were I deceived them. And I said, I wasn't objectifying her. She shoves quarters in her sister's vagina. She talks about wishing she had an abortion. She's a repulsive human being. And, you know, would not hear it. She speaks for all women, according to these women.
What?
Yeah. And she's a brave comedian.
Nobody speaks for all women.
I know. And I said, you identified me as an old white man.
And right.
She began to say, well, you're in a position of power. Your comedy is oppressive.
So what was the end game of this?
The end game was she said to me that your comedy is oppressive. And
okay.
I said, thank you. And I may or may not have a daughter or two that would agree with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I got really angry. And I kept thinking, well, this is why Trump won, but he really didn't. You have to say that because he lost.
Right.
He did lose.
Right.
But you go, okay, I get it. I understand why certain people gravitate to Trump. You're making me feel angry. You're projecting onto me things that I'm not guilty of. And I'm in a bubble. I'm in a white man, liberal Manhattan bubble where I'm kind of immune to what white men in the fly under states, that's what I call those red states.
Right. Well, the fact that you even use that phrase says volumes.
Fly
like,
under.
Have you ever been at a Fleet Farm?
A Fleet Farm?
Yeah.
Yeah, where they grow enema bags. Hmm? The Fleet's
so
in.
Bad.
When gay men go to the Fleet's in, everybody thinks you're talking about the Navy. They're talking about a...
You're talking about gay Christmas. Fleet Week.
Yeah, they go Fleet Week, and they're talking about the enema bag.
In other words, no, you've never been to a Fleet Farm.
I don't know what a Fleet Farm is, but I am in touch.
Well, you should. Okay, I will explore Alan Sherman if you will check out Fleet Farm online.
What
it
is Fleet?
It is a farm equipment supply store that you definitely don't know what it is.
Okay.
Okay.
So what does that have to do with?
Just that I'm proving your point. That you're in a bubble.
And that.
Not of the people.
And that the abstraction of equality
mm-hmm.
and feminism, when you are in a bubble and you're a white man
mm-hmm.
who's finishing out his career,
mm-hmm.
it's easy for somebody like me, actually not so much, because I'm broke. So, and threatened.
Yeah, but that's just because you got divorced.
Okay, but I'm threatened.
By?
Well, I need work. I need money.
That's not threatened. That's just like
financially
needing work.
Yeah, and that even that, and I'm not trying to be contentious here, even that, which you just said, belies your bubble.
No, but I would say that about myself.
That
needing work is not the same as being threatened.
Well, I disagree with you 1,000,000%, because to me, that's what it's all about, honey.
Sorry, don't call me honey. Don't ever fucking do that.
I didn't say that as a woman. Just
apologize immediately
sorry.
I'm walking out the fucking door.
Why? What's wrong with...
Because it's patronizing, you fucking obvious piece of shit.
No, it's like, that is like, not, I wasn't calling you honey.
You literally were looking in
but
my
not,
eyes,
but I
in
wasn't...
my face, and you called me honey.
But
just stop, admit it. Admit it.
I did, but I wasn't.
Now you can't even look me in the eye.
I wasn't calling you honey. It was like me being kind of like a sassy black woman.
You are the exact opposite of a sassy black woman.
Okay, so the bubble that I'm talking about is if you don't see, not you.
If one
doesn't see that financial ruin is taking up so much space in everybody's head, you don't get it. and you don't understand what's going on in this country. And I think we will look back if this country is still around in 4 years.
So are you saying that I'm insensitive to the plight of working class America?
What I'm saying is that when we look back at the wrecking ball that's upon us, mm-hmm. Donald Trump, we will have said, you know what? We all underestimated our own and everybody else's financial despair.
Did wealthy liberals do that? Yes.
I think I've been reading a lot about financial despair. And there was an interesting article about post-traumatic stress syndrome.
Disorder.
From a financial standpoint. Mm-hmm. And the amount of denial that this country is in, that the 99% is in about mm-hmm. their own finances. Because money is shame. There's so much shame associated with money. So much shame about not having it. So much worry about not having
right.
it. So much denial about not having it. Hence, credit card debt. People, you know how Donald Trump says, well, what are you worth? And he says, depends how I feel that day. I mean, he is a shining example of a broke man. He is broke. If he were worth $100 million, he would not be running for president. No man who's worth that kind of money would run for president. Donald Trump is broke. He is absolutely broke. He doesn't own any of these properties. He's leveraged to the hilt.
Okay.
Where I'm going with that is he says it depends how I feel each day, what my net worth is. And that's what 99% of Americans do. They wake up. And because they have credit cards and they have student loans and they have mortgages and houses that are underwater financially, and nobody can really tell you what your house is worth until you actually have to sell it. So you can have an appraiser come in and they'll tell you, you get five appraisers, you get five different values for your property. And nobody really knows what their financial status is. That when Trump said it depends how I feel that day, that's how 99.
Right, you already said that. But so, like, where are we going?
What I'm saying is that you have a nation of people who probably don't realize how financially strapped and terrorized they are right now.
Sure.
And all this talk, and Bernie touched on this, all this talk about your identity as a black person, which is important, or a woman, or a gay, or a transgender person, or Jewish, in many ways, is eclipsed by your financial ruin. And I also understand that you cannot address your financial ruin without addressing racism, because you don't get hired because you're black. That, to me, is the issue.
Right. Or you live in a neighborhood where there's one shitty bank with, like, super high interest rates that you sign the thing and then you get in under, you know, you get in over your head debt-wise. Yep.
And the reason Bernie, to me, was so much more important than Hillary.
How are we talking about Bernie Sanders?
Because
now?
I think that when you talk to an inveterate racist, if you were to corner David Duke and say to him, do you like black people? First of all, he would say yes. You know, as in the abstract, David Duke likes black people. He would say that. Then when you drill down to specifics, if you say to somebody, the most inveterate racist, do you think Mexican Americans should be allowed to work and raise a family? They would say yes. That's what we can all agree on. We can all agree that everybody is entitled to a job
okay.
and to make money.
David,
and that's what brings us all together. We're all part of the 99%.
Sure. Why am I now in, like, a lecture hall with you?
Because
you've been talking like literally nonstop for like 10 minutes.
Because it's something I feel very passionate about.
You can do that without me here.
No, I'm saying, and we live in a, and so.
Which is practically what's happening.
Well, I'm saying that we live in a bubble if we don't acknowledge that we're all financially strapped.
This came out of
the
you
ACLU.
Being outraged at the, right.
That the, and so she called me an oppressive white male. And I thought, who am I oppressing? I'm trying to work and make a living.
Who You're just trying to put food on your family.
I'm just trying to put food on my family.
All right. I'm trying to dig us out of this hole.
I'm not in a hole. I know exactly
where. We are
where
in like a Bernie Sanders
no, I'm
lecture
not.
Hole
no,
right
I'm
now.
No, I'm not. I'm going back to the ACLU.
That's because I just brought
no,
it back.
No. I know exactly where I'm going.
All right. Well, let me know when you want me to chime in again.
that the experience that I had at this ACLU benefit and
yes.
talking to these three rabid liberals was, oh, I get it. I'm a white male. You view me as oppressing the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I ain't oppressing anybody.
Do you think they were oppressing you with their thought police, quote unquote?
I definitely
vibe?
Picked up a lot of resentment, sexism, and racism addressed, pointed at me.
Well, obviously.
And ageism.
But what I'm asking you.
Oh, hang on for 1 second. So you said I don't know where I'm going. I know exactly where I'm going. I'm telling you that walking out of that benefit for the ACLU where I'm trying to help a left-wing group that protects Nazis, I'm trying to help the ACLU. I show up for a liberal cause and three liberals victimized me, accused me of being
right.
Ageism,
we've already
sexism,
been through, yeah.
sexism,
got that.
And racism. And I thought, oh, I can see why Anthony Cumia thinks the way he does. I can see why people in the fly-under states,
sure.
if you're a white male who's broke and my age, I can see why you voted for Trump and almost
yeah because it's
almost,
a fuck you
and almost rightfully so almost rightfully so and then you go and read
it's
the
fuck all you uppity liberal smug people who think you're smarter than me
yeah and it's also who's gonna put food on my table so when I go to the when I go to Breitbart I start reading Breitbart
right none of this is new to me David. I mean, you're not, like, blowing my mind here.
I'm not trying to blow your mind.
Clearly.
I'm not trying to blow your mind. When I go to Breitbart and I read what they write about white people being under attack, white men being under attack.
Right. And you're like, yeah.
Doesn't come out of nowhere. Doesn't come out of nowhere.
No, doesn't.
And as Obama has said, you cannot.
It's pronounced Obummer.
Obummer says, you know, you can't understand. If you don't understand where it's coming from, you can't tackle it. So what do you want to say? You let's move on.
I mean, I know that stuff, so. Like, yeah, that's a thing that's happening in culture.
And what do you think the solution to that is?
Fuck if I know.
Ah. Well, I'll tell you what the solution is.
Oh, good. What is it, David?
We get back to the 99%.
Yeah, but doesn't that conveniently ignore the issue of identity politics, which sets you off on this whole thing in the first place? You're saying it's the economy, stupid? And you're saying that increased prosperity will decrease the resentment of identity politics?
All right.
I say, nah, nah, nah.
All right. Well, am I allowed to talk?
It's a free country for now.
What percentage of Americans in America, what percentage of Americans don't have college degrees? I know the answer to this.
Two-thirds, right?
Very good. Wow.
Yeah, I'm really fucking smart, David. Wow.
Two-thirds of Americans don't have college degrees. And do you have a college degree?
Yes, I do.
And I have a college degree.
Yes.
Do you think I alienate listeners by talking about my college degree?
I wouldn't know because, A, I don't know who is your listener fan base other than basement masturbators.
Well,
I would assume that people who elect to listen to podcasts do so out of a sense of affinity.
Mm-hmm. But in terms of growing my audience and reaching out, getting a bigger audience, I've been told that I offend people by saying I went to college.
What?
Yeah.
Why is that offensive?
It's a turnoff. What? If two-thirds of Americans don't have college degrees.
Well, wait, who's saying – listeners are saying they're offended?
I want to have this guy on the show. There was a very sweet man who – from Minnesota, of all places.
Oh, my home state.
Yes. Who said my complaining about my iPhone – is elitist and turns off the audience because you're signaling.
Okay. Does this guy have a graduate degree?
No.
Does he have a college degree?
No. And he said to me, it's offensive when I listen to you complaining about your iPhone. And I wanted to have him on
the show.
Well,
I mean, it is hella dull to listen to people complain about their iPhones.
But he says you sound like a snob. You don't understand that most people can't afford an iPhone.
Why is that? Why they have a Samsung Galaxy instead?
I'm just saying that there is. I'm just thinking about.
So you're saying you want to turn this podcast into a big, huge mainstream thing, and you're worried that you're going to have to sell out your background and pretend that you didn't go to college or never talk about it?
Well, if you didn't go to college, can you understand the hostility towards people who did?
Sure.
Yeah. You know, I went to Columbia.
Mm-hmm.
I graduated with President Obama.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I almost went to Columbia undergrad.
And here's what I remember. And to me, it's why I identify with the 99% and why I think it's so important. Columbia during the 60s... Columbia created the Weathermen, the uprising in the 60s. It kind of
right.
was ground zero for the movement, the anti-war.
But also, don't you feel like you have a certain sort of like economic populism in your DNA?
Yeah, but I'm gonna
like just family wise.
But I'm gonna tell you what I learned at Columbia, and what Obama didn't learn. So this is, you're going to have, is it okay if I tell you something?
All right, but let's make it quick.
Okay.
I don't want another 20-minute lecture.
Yeah, but it's you're going to have to give me like 3 minutes here.
Two.
Give me 3 minutes.
90 seconds.
Give me 3 minutes because it's really profound.
Alex, are you timing this?
Are you threatened that I'm going to teach you something?
No, you're kind of windy sometimes. So I want you to like succinctify your points.
Okay. So when I started at Columbia, it was after the 60s, and the school was pretty much on the decline because of the radicals. They had seized the offices and taken a lot of studies that had been done for the Pentagon and set them on fire. They did.
I know. I love it.
And they were pretty violent. The Weather Underground came out of Columbia.
Yeah.
And they brought in a new chancellor named McGill. And McGill gave an interview. He said, I am going to put an end to the 60s radical culture here on campus. I swear to God he said this. I'm reading it in the Columbia Spectator, the
sure.
newspaper. He said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to let everybody have their clubs. I'm going to divide and conquer. So I'm going to give the gays a club, and I'm going to give the Jews more clubs, and we're going to have more Palestinian identity here, and we're going to have blacks and Asians and everybody.
Oh, I see where you're going.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He said, and watch what happens. I swear to God, he said this. He said, watch what happens once I allow everybody to be oppressed. And he did it. It became, within 4 years, everybody was just off in their own little identity and stopped attacking the university as a whole. I never forgot that. I never forgot that. And he won. They stopped attacking the administration at the university, and they stopped, and the politics, it's still to this day very, very liberal, but not the way it used to be. He divided and conquered. And I never forgot that. And that's why I filter everything through class struggle. So when when that woman at the ACLU benefit accused me of being an oppressive old white man, I go right back to President McGill, Chancellor McGill, saying, I'm going to divide and conquer these people.
Yeah, but who is the puppet master in this instance?
The 1%. They want us. They want me at an ACLU benefit going home and saying, F the liberals. F those liberal women calling me an old white male. And my feeling threatened by, that's what they want. They divide and conquer us.
Okay. Succinctly done, my friend. That was, I think, about under 3 minutes.
Okay.
Just under the wire.
All right. How frightened are you about what's going to happen to this country?
Pretty frightened. Not psyched.
I mean,
worried about SCOTUS. Very worried
SCOTUS,
about
the Supreme Court
of the United States.
Yeah.
Extremely worried about the passage of FATA. Can I say a few more things?
I just
want to
say
about
Sandra Day O'Connor. It was SCROTUS, and then they had to change it to SCOTUS. Did you know that?
Yeah, it's a really old joke.
Really?
Yeah.
I just made that up.
No, like 500,000 people have done that joke on Twitter.
No. I just made it up.
Well, parallel minds.
Uh-huh. You look like Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah, I'm wearing a hat that I don't really like. It's slightly too tight. My husband got it for me for Christmas a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. and it hurts around the brim or like the band because it's knitted.
All right, so you're worried about the Supreme Court.
Yeah, I'm worried about Roe v. Wade. I'm worried about if FATA passes. I think that could be a nightmare for LGBTQ folks. And, I'm worried about nuclear saber rattling. I mean, I am a child of, like, the Cold War, in 1980, the so-called Miracle on Ice. I was 10 years old,
mm-hmm.
That stuff is very much, like, part of my childhood growing up. It's like worrying about getting nuked by the Soviet Union. And I feel like all those fears are coming up again, even though Putin pretends to be friends with Donald Trump. We all know he's clowning him. We all know that Putin is like 100,000 times smarter than Donald Trump. He's like 5 million steps ahead of him. Mm-hmm. Actually, my father-in-law, who is quite right-wing, very like Wall Street Journal, editorial board, sis boomba, free market Republican, not a social conservative.
Right.
He had the observation that Rex Tillerson actually may be a good move as Secretary of State because ExxonMobil has better intel than even the CIA from like a geopolitical standpoint.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
Well, I don't agree. I suspect he's right.
Yeah.
They have the best climate scientists.
Yes.
They really do.
I know. They do. And
they are a state into their own. They are their own separate nation.
Correct.
They have a foreign policy.
Yeah.
They have.
Right. They have contractors
mm-hmm.
basically working as mercenaries.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My father-in-law cited that example of Tillerson's ExxonMobil standing up to Putin being like, no, motherfucker, we got this oil. You can't tell us to give it over to Rosneft or whatever. Like, we're not going to do it. So I thought that was interesting.
He's also pretty good on climate change, Rex Tillerson. He is.
Mm-hmm.
He believes that climate change is man-made. So it could be a Nixon goes to China kind of thing where
it could.
Maybe you require somebody like Rex Tillerson to say, no, we're going to, now that we've shored up our conservative base
mm-hmm.
and you trust us.
Right.
Guess what, folks? Climate change is a mortal threat to the planet.
Right. Now that we got all the oil we're going to get, now that we have to flip over to solar panels, let's demonize climate change and clamp down on India and China and their air quality and shit. I also feel like from a straight-up riot point of view, India and China are not far behind making some serious changes because a lot of the big cities there are untenable in terms of places to live.
That's our projecting optimism onto venality. I mean, these people...
It's not optimism to predict global riots.
Oh, no, I'm just no, I'm talking about Rex Tillerson.
Yes.
Being
yes,
Nixonian.
I know. We're like a pair of Thomas Friedmans here.
Yeah.
And that's a sentence I never thought would come out of my mouth.
I think with Russia that Russia is not as bad as Obama wants us to believe.
Really?
Yeah.
I do.
Well, Crimea.
Bad.
It was very bad, but it did belong to the Russians.
It was. At one point.
And they kind of view it the way we view Cuba. You know, it's something that it's very...
A great place to vacation?
Well, some would say that...
Actually, that's true.
Yeah, some would say that the Russians are entitled to Crimea, and it's not up to us.
Well, Russophiles would say that.
Yeah, and that Russia is not as big a threat to America. They don't have the military.
Not no more.
They don't have the gross national product that we have. They don't have the army that we have. That they are genuinely threatened by the expansion of NATO. And that one of the reasons Putin seized Crimea was the EU was going to bring Ukraine
right
into
yeah.
their economic orbit.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, it has to make up for for England. The EU has to make
EU,
up
yeah.
for
but
England
that,
piecing out.
But that we were that we were moving in, the Western economies were moving in on Russia, and Putin was saying, hey, wait a second here. I have to protect my people, and he was creating his own little version of the EU, that they're not as scary as Obama wants us to believe, except for the nuclear weapons.
Except for the cyber hacking, cyber terrorism. I mean, those guys are so fucking good. Guccifer 2.0 was a Russian hacker.
How do you know that, though?
Because it was proved like eight times over. They like got all his IPs.
But, you know, they hacked. What they did is they hacked the DNC's server, which is bad.
No, but they've done so many other things besides that.
But they didn't hack our election. They hacked information that allowed us to be.
Yeah, the disinformation campaign.
It's bad.
It's bad. Why are you sticking up for Russia? This is kind of odd.
Oh, I am, because I think China's a lot worse.
Oh, you got no doubt. I mean, China has got a fucking military. Russia's now like, eh.
And China is the real threat. And China is the real human rights.
China owns us.
And Trump.
Financially.
Trump is right about China.
Yeah.
So yeah. this is all.
But China doesn't hate our fucking guts
yes,
the way
do.
That Russia does.
Yes, they. China.
If they really hated us, they wouldn't be making the iPhones. I'm serious. They like the money too much. China's hoeier than Russia. Russia fucking hates us. China, like, hates us and also is like, the price is right.
China is a lot worse than Russia and a bigger threat.
Oh, China is much scarier.
Yeah.
But I'm saying that there's a much more ambivalent relationship there. Like, China is always going to get its panties in a bunch about fucking Taiwan and Hong Kong and Tibet and whatever. No one else gives a fuck. No one cares about the South China Sea except China. Fine.
Okay. I think you've been brainwashed.
What?
Yeah. You remember you got to believe the Miracle on Ice.
I'm not saying you got to believe the Miracle on Ice. Did I give a fuck about Miracle on Ice? Hell no.
I think you grew up fearing nuclear annihilation.
You know what? If fearing a nuclear annihilation is wrong, I don't want to be right.
From the Russians.
Yes.
And what this administration, Obama, is doing is preying on that, the dark recesses of your brain, remembering Russia as the evil empire, the same way George W. Bush preyed on the dark recesses of our brain, fearing Saddam Hussein. That we're fighting an old war.
First of all, I resent being accused of being brainwashed.
Oh, I think you are. I think Americans are brainwashed. It's very easy.
And you're not.
Yeah, I'll say I've been brainwashed. We were raised to fear the Russians. It's an easy default. The same way we were raised in 2001.
Cannot the fears be like tiered, T-I-E-R-E-D.
But they're exploited. George W. Bush and Cheney exploited.
I knew we would start talking about this.
They exploited our fear of Saddam Hussein in 2001 to take our eye off the ball. We should have been attacking bin Laden and Saudi Arabia. But they say,
why are we talking about this?
Because I'm saying that what we're doing now with Russia is we're taking our eye off the ball. The real enemy is China. And Trump is right about this. We don't want to address that. So we conveniently go to the dark recesses of our brain and go, ooh, evil Putin. Yeah, Putin's evil, the same way Saddam Hussein is evil.
Yeah, but I'm not saying that Russia's more evil than China. I feel like you're a little bit putting words in my mouth.
Well, I'm saying this hacking thing is bad.
China has incredibly sophisticated. They hacked the Wall Street Journal and the Times.
Yeah.
And they're committing genocide. Goldman Sachs. Did you know that?
Yeah, they're committing genocide in Tibet.
Well, they've been doing that.
They are committing genocide. They are, if you're in China, I'm wrapping it up. Hang on for 1 second. Do you know that if you had more children than you were allowed to,
you're forced to have an abortion, yeah.
The extra children that are born are not entitled to any benefits?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do know that.
I know you know that. I'm talking to my listeners. That's horrific. I mean, this is a pretty...
They did relax that policy, though. You got to admit.
They're just beginning to relax it. I mean,
it's been like 6 years.
Okay, so Obama has been taking it pretty easy on China, and Trump calling this out.
Feel like some of that was TPP-based, though?
In terms of being against the Pacific trade?
Was in terms of like playing it both ways, depending on which way the TPP went.
For whom? Trump or Obama?
No, for Obama.
Well, he was for TPP.
Yeah, but like...
And so was Hillary.
Yeah, but he...
Not until Bernie.
I'm saying I feel like he was playing it both ways. Like neither going hard on China nor being super soft on China. Do you know what I'm saying?
What I'm saying is that China is a mortal threat to the United States, and it's something that is inconvenient for Wall Street and this country, and I don't like Trump.
What?
But Putin is Hussein. It's a distraction. He didn't do anything all that bad. China is bin Laden, and it's an uncomfortable truth.
I think Putin is crummy. I think China's worse.
Yeah.
I don't think Putin is not that bad.
Putin is bad, but he's not as bad as China.
I feel like we've both said the same thing like six times in a row.
Okay. All right.
Sorry to the listeners for this repetitive, mind-numbing experiment in logorrhea.
Logorrhea, diarrhea of the mouth.
Yes.
Okay. And that's why they hate us.
Hey, fair enough.
Colleen Werthmann, when do you leave?
I go back to L.A. on New Year's Day.
Well, are you going to come back here at all?
Probably not before mid-March. I don't know. That's when this contract is up. It's 10 episodes on TV Land. It starts January 17th, so that takes us through whatever, I guess, mid-March, mid to end of March.
I have a new
Then
fear.
I don't know what happened. What's going on there?
I had a rough night at the bathhouse.
Those classic stale gay sex jokes from the 80s. Look at you with that dog-eared copy of Bright Lights Big City in your pocket.
He's a well-respected writer, Jay McEnany.
Is he, though?
Yeah, he is.
By whom?
His
Wine Spectator. Blam!
All right. Here's my... I have a couple more notes that I just want to get off my chest. Before
Alex is groaning in the control room.
You know what?
Come on, basement masturbators, stick with us.
You're both being negative towards me, and I don't care because I think this has been an entertaining show, and nobody's going to wear me down. This has been a great show.
Don't put your shit about the British people onto me.
I'm just saying, you can be negative, and you can. Accuse me of talking too much, but everything I'm saying is correct and interesting and profound, and you can't hear it anywhere else. And I stand by everything I've said today because I'm brilliant and I spend a lot of time reading and I know a lot of stuff and I'm politically correct.
Are you saying this out loud for your own self?
No. I am not going to be worn down by anybody. I'm not. I'm just not. So nobody's going to wear me down or make me feel that these profound ideas are not valid. Here is my closing thought. We all missed the boat on Trump. Everybody was saying he's never going to get elected president. But every step of the way we said, but you know what? They deserve it. So here's the question I'm going to leave this audience with for this new year. He is a mortal threat to the planet. Along the way, we said, you know, I don't like him, but the Republicans deserve it. The question is now, does America deserve it? That's the question. And we'll find out in the next 2 years. Hey, Colleen, thank you for coming on the show. Always a delight.
Well.
Please friend me on... please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, and do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. And give us a good review on iTunes from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Los Angeles. God, I keep saying Los Angeles. Where are we? Manhattan. Well, it is a...
In New York City's East Village.
In New York City's East Village, that'll do it for us. Coming up, film critic Michael Snyder. You're listening to The David Feldman Show. Please remember to friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, do all your Amazon shopping, please, 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 over at the David Feldman Show website. If you're doing some shopping, hit the contact button. Let me know so I can thank you. Also, just tell me what you think of the show by hitting the contact button. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Subscribe to us on Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel now. Subscribe to the show on YouTube. It's just audio. It's just audio, but you can listen to it on YouTube. Spread the links. Spread the word. If you like a show, tell everybody. Tell me. And now, film critic Michael Snyder. Joining us is our resident film critic, Michael Snyder. These are the movies he'll be talking about. Eye in the Sky, Loving, Hidden Figures, Zootopia, Jackie, and Pablo Neruda. Tell me about Eye in the Sky.
Well, let's preface all this by saying these are six films from 2016 that I think are worthy and important and that people should seek out and watch for a variety of reasons. Not a best of list. It's not anything of that nature. Let's put this in context, you know. But Eye in the Sky came out much earlier in 2016, and it's a film that I think is totally relevant and totally topical. It's about the current era of international terrorism, about drone warfare, and invasive high-tech surveillance. It goes into the consequences of fighting this ruthless, elusive enemy with, you know, I guess you'd call it imprecise technology, especially when it's in the hands of human beings. The movie shows what can happen when innocents are thrust in the middle of the conflict and soldiers and agents have to deal with their individual and sometimes conflicting values for, I guess, what people would call the greater good. Helen Mirren is the star, and she's so elegant and beautiful and sexy, but here she plays a no-nonsense British Army colonel who's using an American drone in conjunction with the U.S. military to finally find this longtime nemesis that she has, a U.K. citizen who joined a Kenyan terrorist organization. But when she finds the target, she sees the target is overseeing the launch of multiple suicide bombings. So they order a missile strike, except a little girl wanders into the kill zone. The drone pilot is played by Aaron Paul from Breaking Bad. The tremendous Alan Rickman, sadly one of the talented people who departed the Earth in 2016 and not in a rocket ship. No, he died. Alan Rickman plays a fellow British military officer in London who is trying to debate whether or not there's a moral reason to go in there and do this as the timers tick. Jeremy Northam, Ian Glenn, it's a fantastic piece of work, and there's a real gravitas to this. The question is one life a child's worth so many other, you know, to stop so many other deaths? The director's Gavin Hood, who I guess he was the director of the Oscar-winning South African film Tsotsi, but he also did Ender's Game and X-Men Origins, a Wolverine film, so he's done a lot of commercial stuff, but he handles the moral and ethical dilemmas here with such sensitivity, and the action sequences are so tense. I mean, this is a clear and present story that's ongoing and is probably going to ratchet up this year, so I thought Eye in the Sky is very timely and something people should seek out.
Loving.
Loving is a very powerful and understated, historical, but real relevant and topical movie. A docudrama that has a heart and a mind and a very noble purpose. I mean, it shows in no uncertain terms the inhuman, bigoted, and petty-minded elements of society that existed in America and even exists now, as we well know, that run counter to human rights and in all too many cases, like I said, still linger in the 21st century. It's about the real-life commitment of an interracial couple, Richard and Mildred Loving. That, really, that's their surname. Brilliantly portrayed by Joel Edgerton from Down Under and Ruth Negga from the UK. And Ruth Negga is getting wonderful notes on this. She's done some work here in the States and back home. I don't know if you saw The Night Of, the American miniseries on HBO. It was adapted from a British miniseries called Criminal Justice, and Ruth Negga was in that in 2008. She's been working for a number of years, and here she really gets a chance to make an impact as Mildred Loving. They married and then have fought for 9 years so she could be this man's wife and he could be her husband in their hometown, which was in Virginia. This whole idea of Virginia is for lovers, yeah, well, check this out. So the writer-director Jeff Nichols, who also has brought these incredibly original and memorable and inherently philosophical movies, Mud, Take Shelter, and Midnight Special, is just wonderful and goes total docudrama with Loving. And yet he captures the spirit and emotion, all the elements that make the Loving story true, tragic, and resonant. He's made the personal political with Loving, and everybody delivers the goods in this thing.
Do we know if they stay married?
They did. They were devoted to one another.
Yeah, it's kind of tough to get a divorce after you go through all that.
Well, now the cynic in you is showing, but I do believe they loved one another so dearly that the tides of society and history were broached and breached by their love. So one would hope that they did stick it out together and cared for one another unto the later parts of their lives. I don't remember the details of their passing or if anyone's still with us, but kudos to the loving, brave, courageous, and bold people.
John Glenn was the first American to orbit the Earth, and he passed away last year in 2016.
Yep.
And there's a new movie about his flight called Hidden Figures.
Well, it's about more than his flight. It could have been all messagey and overbearing, but it was instead heartfelt and engaging. It's an historical drama about three African-American women who are tasked to provide NASA with important mathematical data needed to launch the program's earliest space missions. And it stars a power-packed trio of actresses, Taraji P. Henson, who people know as Cookie on Empire, and before that she was on Person of Interest as a hard-as-nails cop, a wonderful character, Octavia Spencer, who's an Oscar winner, and Janelle Monáe, a pop singer who clearly is a superior actress and may have started out. I get the feeling she was like a theater kid and then she moved into music, but people knew her as sort of a flamboyant theatrical pop singer, but she's gotten into acting in spades, pardon the expression. I mean, she's truly wonderful in this, and she was also quite great in Moonlight. Kevin Costner is also in this thing, Kirsten Dunst, and from The Big Bang Theory of all people, Jim Parsons. Anyway, the story is, well, we see these women as they have been shunted to one side and forced to use colored-only bathrooms at the NASA headquarters where they're working, and it's remarkable when they are proven to have so much skill and talent that they are brought into the fold despite a lot of bigotry and prejudice on the part of those around them. It's funny, the depiction of John Glenn in this movie is wonderful. He's one of the few people that goes over to the African-American contingent, which is more than just these three women. They're all working on computations, and introduces himself and is warm and open to them, while a lot of the stiff bastards in the NASA crew keep their distance, the white ones, the white male oppressors, if you will. Anyway, you get sterling work from Henson, and Spencer redeems herself after playing a sleazy hooker in the vulgar but rampantly unfunny Bad Santa 2. These are real women, and we do see in an epilogue what became of them, and they were brilliant and talented, and they ended up being integral to the launch of John Glenn into orbit, which was a big turnaround for the Americans during the space race in the 1960s, and eventually ended up with an American flag being planted on the moon, for better or worse. And I say Hidden Figures is definitely worth watching, whether at home on the big screen at your house or at the theater.
You're still pushing the American propaganda that man actually landed on the moon.
Yeah, Stanley Kubrick's Ghost and I had a long conversation about that. He did not fake the moon landing. He says that anyone who thinks otherwise is a tinfoil hat-wearing lunatic.
Zootopia.
Well, here's an interesting case where an animated movie has the kind of depth and meta-text to tell us something about our society in very clear and cogent ways. It's a renaissance at Disney Animation when Zootopia and the more recent Moana. Let's not confuse the star of a Disney cartoon with a wonderful singer and actress. But in any regard, Zootopia was earlier in the year and Moana was later, but Zootopia is the one with the real richness and depth. It's fast moving, it's funny, beautifully animated, and the message gets a little mixed here and there, but the movie presumes a world like ours, only where generally civilized anthropomorphic animals coexist, species by species, in both urban and rural areas. And in fact, there are these kind of, I won't call them ghettos, but neighborhoods where certain animals tend to flock. So there's that going on here. Anyway, there are various different sectors in the big city of Zootopia with different climates and citizen species. They're habitats, if you will, more than neighborhoods. And even though there's a lot of intermingling, especially at the city center, and a centralized civic government and dedicated police force, they really have a tough time getting along in places. So the cops are the biggest, baddest mammals until an earnest young rabbit named Judy Hopps decides she's going to be the first fluffy little bunny on the police force. So she's dealing with political corruption and a serious crime wave, and even worse, she's derided by her colleagues on the force as a lightweight. So she ends up teaming with a sort of a snitch, if you will, a con artist, a fox, natural enemy to rabbits, even in Zootopia, to try to solve the case of police corruption and government corruption. The idea of these creatures goes far beyond the concept of predator and prey, and it goes into the idea of maturing out of their natural instinct to mistrust one another and get along. And that's at the heart of the movie, and hey, what a wonderful subtext. What's right on top? Let's not call it a subtext. Anyway, this computer animated movie from Disney, post Pixar, is almost up there with all the very best Pixar Disney movies like Inside Out. And it's better than some of the more recent films that Pixar's done, like The Good Dinosaur. So, you know, good going, Disney. This movie, Zootopia, is really worth people watching. The whole family will get a kick out of this thing, and if it's not available on video already, it should be.
And Jackie, is this about a comedian?
Oh, yeah, Jackie Rogers Jr., starring the wonderful Martin Short as the... Oh, no, that's not it. Excuse me. Jackie is a movie that offers Natalie Portman a virtual sure shot as a Best Actress nominee at the Oscars. She truly delivers the goods here as Jacqueline Kennedy in what I believe is a fresh take on this very, very familiar and tragic piece of American history. And again, it's pretty damned relevant today to see Jackie Kennedy in the 60s when the concept of the so-called best and brightest running the U.S. executive branch, embodied in the 60s by John Kennedy and his wife Jacqueline, is now deemed quaint or outmoded. I mean, the role of president and first lady are about to be assumed by what appears to be the antithesis to JFK and his highly educated, articulate, stylish, and classy wife. We'll say no more about that for the moment. But anyway, Portman portrays Jacqueline Kennedy right before, during, and after her husband was shot in 1963. And Natalie Portman was the same age as Jackie was when her husband was shot, around 34. So this is a pretty good combo of actress and role. It's directed by the Chilean filmmaker Pablo Larraín, who did the wonderful, also recent biopic, Neruda, about the poet from Chile, Pablo Neruda, and also the great political thriller, No, which was about the campaign to take down Chile's the military dictator, Augusto Pinochet, in 1988. This guy is wonderful. Pablo Larraín makes wonderful films. His work is artistically bold and so far politically themed, and Portman is great in this thing. It's truly a heartbreaker, and some of the casting is top drawer, starting with Portman as Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy, even though he's a good actor. Peter Sarsgaard did not convince me that he was Robert Kennedy. On the other hand, I'll be frank with you, it's really remarkable to see John Carroll Lynch as Lyndon Johnson and Beth Grant as Lady Bird. They nailed it. And there's also a good turn by Greta Gerwig as Nancy Tuckerman, who was Jackie's best friend. So for the most part, this thing is first rate. And one of the interesting conceits about the film is her conversations, which are from transcripts in large part, are instigated by a journalist unnamed who comes to interview her in Hyannisport after the assassination of Kennedy. Billy Crudup plays the journalist, and he's quite good. There's also supporting work by Richard E. Grant and John Hurt, the great John Hurt, who plays a priest and confessor to Jackie. And thumbs up for this, all of my thumbs, because I believe it's a terrific piece of docudrama. And, of course, plenty of biography instilled there as well.
All one of your thumbs.
All of my thumbs, yes.
All one of them. We won't talk about your gambling problem. Pablo Neruda. Tell me about the movie Pablo Neruda.
Well, it's not the title. It's called Neruda. And this is, again, another biopic from the Chilean director Pablo Larraín. And it's not going to get the justifiable attention that he's getting for Jackie, but it's a fine piece of movie making that should get attention in the foreign film category when award season hits its height. It's about the politically charged hunt for this Nobel Prize-winning Chilean poet and politician, Pablo Neruda, in the 40s when he was a fugitive in his own country, Chile, because of his membership in the Communist Party and also his rabble-rousing. It's not faithful to the facts like Jackie, where Lorraine used transcripts and recreations. At one point in Jackie, he actually reshoots Jacqueline Kennedy's CBS broadcast a tour of the White House, which had never been done before in any medium. And here he's talking about Neruda through a mixture of biographical notes and fictional contrivance from the point of view of an investigator who's leading the search to find and maybe censor and jail Neruda despite the poet's popularity. The investigator is kind of conflicted because he admires Neruda's art and skill, and he's played by maybe the only familiar face in this cast, who would be the marvelous Mexican leading man, Gael García Bernal, who is best known as the star of Amazon's Mozart in the Jungle on streaming TV, a show I can't recommend high enough, and also many renowned Spanish language movies, including Lorraine's feature, No. It's a pretty wonderful film and very unconventional in how it tells its story about Neruda. Again, I think this guy, Lorraine, is one hell of a director, a fantastic director, and great stuff. I think you might be able to see this on Netflix sooner or later, but no matter what, I think Neruda and Jackie show the director Pablo Lorraine to be a force in filmmaking. And again, all six of these films are movies that I thought were important that were released in 2016 and deserve your attention.
Well, you'll come back. We'll talk Golden Globes and Oscars and all that sort of nonsense. How do people reach you and follow you?
Oh, they can go to Twitter and check me out at Culture Blaster on Twitter. That's one word, Culture Blaster. They can go to the Facebook Michael Snyder's Culture Blast page and hear my online reviews from Roku, my stuff with you and our friend Mark Thompson, and also read articles I've written in the Marina Times, which you can also get to via marinatimes.com. And there's stuff about movies from 2016 that fell through the cracks that people should see, whether they were entertainment or significant. That's currently available there. And I guess that's it until we meet up again, buddy.
Thank you, Michael.
You're welcome.
That's our show. Thank you, Colleen Werthmann. Thank you, Michael Snyder. Go see those movies. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. We're updating that website all the time. Do your Amazon shopping there. Give us a good review on iTunes. Give us a good review on Stitcher. Give us a good review on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel, so check it out. David Feldman Show on YouTube. And give us a thumbs up. Subscribe to that channel. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Give us a good review on iTunes. Give us a good review on Stitcher. Well, I'm talking about reviews because we just had Michael Snyder. $5 a month, you get access to all our premium content. What else do I want you to do? Give to Planned Parenthood and St. Jude's and the ACLU. From the show Briz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.